For the Christmas holidays, we came up with the idea of a fun little diorama. A diorama featuring an ultramarine opening his presents and, in the main one, a life-size Necron target practice from Daddy Gilliman. Assembly required. Now, we initially wanted this video released before Christmas, but all the family got super sick before and during the holidays. So it took a lot more time than what we planned, but here, you have it. The idea was to build something that would look fun and nice enough, without spending a crazy amount of time on this project. This was also the occasion to try a few AK interactive paints recently purchased, and give you a quick opinion on how they fare and if they are a good fit for us. So, without further ado, let's get started. For this project, we are using an Intercessor model, a Necron warrior, and a swarm of Canoptech scarabs with one of them placed under the Space Marine boot. Separating the scarabs from each other took a lot of care and patience, as their limbs and carapaces are overlapping in many places. Then, we trimmed off every peg to be able to freely reposition arms and head. Because the hobby knife blade isn't enough to cut through thick plastic, we're using a saw blade to separate the left leg from the body. This will let us reposition the Marine from a running to a standing position. We are using Tamiya extra thin plastic cement to assemble all the parts. We used a small piece of polystyrene to support and balance the scarab, which made it much easier to properly position and glue the right leg. To fill up a hole like this, nothing like a blob of sprue glue and a few pieces of styrene stuffed over it. This is creating a very strong bond and is way more efficient than using clay. It is also making it easy to adjust the position while the solvent evaporates. A bit of plastic cement to smooth out the connection, and a small pouch is reused to make the connection seamless. The right arm with open hand comes from a Sergeant Intercessor model and is perfect to hold the Necron's head. For the left arm, the blade was carefully removed to make a grasping fist. Any remaining plastic was then shaved and filed using a sanding stick. The front part of the Necron's head was then glued inside the right hand using sprue glue to fill up any gap. I can very easily reposition both arms and ensure a tight fit. Part of the Necron's leg is cut off above and under the ankle. The two parts of the leg are then glued on both sides of the hand, making it as if the Space Marine is holding the leg by the ankle. To make the cardboard Christmas tree, we use a simple plastic card, on which we traced and cut the silhouette. And here's the result. For the box containing the Necron, we used a thin cardboard, sanding the edges with a rougher sanding stick, and gluing the parts together with PVA glue. I am also using the same glue to seal the cardboard. For the Christmas light decorations, we decided to use the smaller scarabs, and quickly realized how tricky it would be to separate them from each other. Still, I successfully managed to harvest every one of the scarabs without losing any of my fingertip nonetheless. As some of the elements were overlapping in a mass of plastic, I had to recreate a few parts by trimming and shaving it away. Look at those, they make perfect Christmas ornaments for the tree. To make the Necron model kit, we are going to dismember this Necron wire, cutting off both legs at the hip level. The weapon was carefully removed from the right arm without losing the thumb. A little bit of filing and some plastic cement to dissolve and smooth out the surface. I used the sanding pad and my hobby knife to clean up the hips, and could then proceed to assemble the torso. The inside of the torso was looking a little weird without the arms attached, so I stuffed it with bits of styrene melted with plastic cement. We had this decade-old Magiscope laying around from our sculpting days. Oh, the catalyzing part looks terrible. This is not mixing well, which is a sign that one of the parts has gone really bad. Still, even in that state, I'll be able to use it to fill up the torso. I am smoothing it with a little bit of water, press two ball joints, and that's it. We can let it cure. Meanwhile, we're going to work on the Space Marine with a bit of sculpting. This time using Epoxy Sculpt by Aves, which is a much better compound. His butt plates need some reconstruction after repositioning the left leg. Some rough shaping before refining and smoothing the plates with a shaper. This doesn't need to be perfectly detailed, just clean enough. After all, nobody is going to sneak under to check between his legs. The Necron faceplate needed some extension to look better inside the hand. And added extra cables sticking out made from aluminium and copper wires. Should we be using decals or make something silly instead? Yeah, I thought so. Instead, I'm going to make a sheet of aluminium from a soda can. You can make a ton of fun stuff with this, like this absurdly tiny Ultramar symbol that I glued over the right shoulder plate, making it stick out from the surface. We also made extra pretty seals to fill up the gap left by the patch. The symbol was then merged to the pauldron using epoxy sculpt. For the base, we use a simple plastic lid engraved to look like a floor panels. Yeah, we definitely burned the budget on that one. Prison boxes were made out of small pieces of styrene, and it looks like someone is getting a new bottle for Christmas. We use the same sheet of aluminium to make all the ribbons. This is ideal to create thin and sturdy elements that can be worked with pliers. You can even shape it with your fingers to get a very natural look. With all the elements built, let's proceed to the painting step, starting with spraying the primer and the base color. We are using Valero Ghost Grey Surface Primer in a few thin and even layers. For the base color, I am using AK Deep Blue with a drop of Valero Air Black. And rather than starting with a classic Zenithal as a base, the darker color will give deeper shadows. This was my first time using AK Surgeon paints and I am experimenting on the fly. It will take some time to get used to how those colors behave and look, but they are definitely giving a good first impression. I then applied a few layers of Deep Blue over the most exposed part. And while we could have used the quote marks official color, the idea here is to test the paint range that we just purchased. While brighter than Macrack Blue, this should give us a nice base to work with. On to priming and base painting the various Necron parts. We'll start with Wine Red by AK Interactive, which is a pretty intense and interesting color. Again, spraying it in two or three thin layers. And while I am using an airbrush here for speed, I could very well do the same with a brush. Next, I am using a mix of AK Wine and Deep Reds to create a blend toward the brighter part of each element, completely avoiding the side that won't be visible. Last, with Deep Red, this time only over the most exposed parts. Onto priming the base and painting each element. Starting with deep green and a touch of Valero Black for the Christmas tree, spraying a few thin layers until getting a nice and even color. The base itself is painted with Valero Air Black. Last, I repeat the same process for all the prison boxes. With priming and the base color done for each element, we can begin the brushwork, starting with the Ultramarine. We're making a wash with AK Purple, Deep Blue and a touch of Valero Black. Some thinner and Flow Improver to make it fit and help getting in the recesses. I could have used water instead of a thinner, but I wanted to test if the AK Surgeon paint underneath would reactivate. Yes, experimenting on a miniature while you are on a tight schedule is pretty dumb. But who has time to make test pieces and avoid screwing up miniatures? For the record, both Valero Thinner and Flow Improver are causing the AK Surgeon to reactivate, which was expected to happen and can be easily avoided. I'm carefully applying this dark purple wash in each recess. I find this color to look more interesting than plain black, but obviously both are fine. I am using Deep Blue and AK Glaze Medium to pass over most of the exposed edges and areas of the armor. If I were to speed paint a Space Marine, this step alone would be enough to make the model pop. Here, it is about building the groundwork for further edge highlighting. As you can see, those highlights are pretty large, and I am mostly using the side of my brush over the sharpest edges. Again, my first impression on AK Interactive 3rd Gen paints is very positive. They have a very nice consistency and coverage. I'm also glazing the brighter color over the exposed panels, using the glaze medium to keep my paint thin and transparent. This is quick work. We're not trying to make a competition piece here. Helmets, though, are always an important element on a model, and most of the time will be where you want to put some real effort on your paint job. Actually, if you want to save time when painting minis but with a table plus look, find two or three parts on a model that catches the most your attention and paint them at the highest standard that you can achieve. This will be all you need to make them look amazing on the battlefield. We are now applying the exact same process to the backpack. Using Valero Air Black, I am painting everything that is either armor joints or metallic elements. We should get our hands on the AK Surgeon Black to see how we like it. The Valero Air Black is nice and smooth, but it is also very fluid, and we often need a paint with a bit more body. I wanted to try a Ducat and Deep Blue mix to further highlight the model. And while it is fun to try new colors, we'll see later that this was not what I had in mind. Without prior experience with a particular paint range, mixing pigments can lead to different results than what you anticipated. But anyway, this is part of the learning process, and we must take everything as an opportunity to improve and better understand our tools. I am going all in with that Ducat Blue for another round of highlights, this time limiting it to a few elements that are worth the attention. And this is where I realized how the brighter base, which was fine on its own, is leading to a much brighter model once highlighted with that Ducat Blue. A little too bright for an Ultramarine? Maybe, so I'm going to fix it. I am mixing Deep Blue with the AK Glaze Medium to make it transparent and spray it over the whole model to slightly shift the hue without losing the highlights. This is the kind of situation where an airbrush makes all the difference. Back to the brush with a Deep Blue and Ivory mix. The first thing that you should notice is that while the overall color might be better, the Glaze Medium made the paint look quite shiny. This will of course be easy to fix with a thin layer of matte varnish, but for someone who prefers a matte finish, this was a little annoying to look at. Anyway, I find that brightening Deep Blue with Ivory makes for much nicer highlights. Let's do the same for the backpack. They might look a little boring at times, but I do like painting backpacks. Maybe it's something about putting as much time and effort as on a Space Marine for something that most people won't care too much about. I am painting Hull Red as a brown over each element that is going to be either gold or leather. Brown is usually a good undercoat for gold, but in this case it is because at the time we were not sure if the gold would be NMM or True Metallics. And from there we could go either way. Oh, and if you haven't guessed what is inside his holster, keep watching. I added a bit of ivory to Hull Red as a base to the pretty seals, still experimenting with how those paints are mixing together, but also because those paints were both available on my wet palette, and I just got lazy. But anyway, limiting your palette is generally a good idea. And reusing available pigments over different parts of your model help tying up everything together. For the Necron parts, we are mixing the same wine and deep red that we use with the airbrush for the rest of the body. The tricky part when mixing colors is to get the same consistency and color matching between hand painting and airbrushing. Remember about taking notes of your mixing ratios, which I of course didn't do. A thin and transparent layer of deep red over this and we should get pretty close. This is not perfect, but that will do just fine. I can reuse the same color for the wax, but with a higher ratio of wine red. And while we are on the pretty seals, let's brighten them up with a higher ratio of ivory for hull red. Next, creating extra volume on the Necron parts with deep red, painting thin layers over the areas that are most illuminated. Black over the articulations and cabling, before painting the lenses in deep red. I should have totally painted those in black before. Oops, I might have crushed the Necron's leg. With a mix of deep red and ice yellow, I am edge highlighting the Necron. Ice yellow is a very good alternative to white when mixing with red. It won't turn to pink as when you are using white or orange when you are using yellow. The result is more in between and looks rather natural. Those dead eyes are going to be black. I am doing some surgery here to fix the leg that I crushed, but I actually ended up drilling foot and leg to add a tiny metal rod inside. Painting those lenses black first would have been a lot easier than having to add a black lining around them. I am then painting a smaller area with deep red mixed with volcanic yellow. A few brighter highlights on the Necron's head with ivory with a touch of deep red. The joints are also highlighted with what is already available on the palette, ivory and black. Edge highlights are also painted on the pretty seals with ivory mixed to what's left of the previous mix. A few very simple writings and a touch of brown glaze over the pretty seals to add some depth. We still have a limited selection of AK brown paints, and rather than reach for our value range, I am working on the leather with a wild mix of hull red, beige red, volcanic yellow, and ivory, progressively adding texture and scratches to the leather. I am no expert in painting leathers, but hey, practice makes you at least a little bit better. I am further edge highlighting the armor with ivory and a hint of deep blue. And unlike a full heavy metal style, you can see that I am only adding this to the top of a very few panels. There is some economy at play here, as what we aim for with this diorama is nice, clean and done in a reasonable time. There's no point pushing the paint job further than what's needed to make it look good as a whole. Also, this is a very silly diorama and we are just having fun here. Final round of highlights on the backpack. This was actually the first time that I used a magnifying lens to paint a mini, and while I still have a pretty good macro vision, this is definitely making it less straining for your eye muscle, and I'm clearly not as young anymore. Talking about silly, what do you think about that candy cane in the holster? I am painting it here in that classic red and white pattern. A few brighter highlights on the Necron for some eye candy, and this ultramarine is coming along pretty nicely. Time to paint all those gold elements that we base coated in brown. And why make it simple when you can make it fun and challenging? We decided to try liquid gold by Valero, which is not an acrylic paint. Those are true metal pigments in an alcohol-based suspension. You absolutely shouldn't use your fancy natural hairbrushes with alcohol paints. And the only synthetic ones that we have are completely wrecked. Have fun painting details with a brush with no tip and bristle going every direction. This type of paint is gorgeously shiny compared to the acrylic ones. But except if you are very confident with your brush control, you shouldn't use them for the kind of detailed work that I'm doing here. First, this is alcohol based, so the only way to clean a mishap and remove gold pigments from a surface is washing it with alcohol. You better protect your paint job. See how I fixed the glossiness on the armor? I used the Mecha Matte Varnish by Valero. And while it is a tough one, I did not wait 24 hours for maximum durability. Which means that any spilling, like I am about to do here on the torso, will need to be fixed by repainting over the armor. This is not a big deal, seeing how thin this paint is, but still, better be careful. Coverage is spotless and a single layer is definitely enough. Was it worth a risk? Probably not, but hey, it is very shiny. So shiny that I'm dirtying that up with a shade of black. You might want to use brown instead if you are looking for a warmer look. We got this Canoptic alloy paint in an edition of Warhammer Imperium. And as we decided to not use alcohol-based paint this time, we opted to try it mixed with a bit of black for the other metallic parts. Because yes, you can have too much fun. This is not as good as Valero Metal Color for airbrush, but obviously good enough. The orb thing on the scarab is painted with ivory to prepare for the fluo paint. Last edge highlights with mostly ivory and a touch of deep blue. Once again, saving these for a few edges that are standing out. This is a very economical way to approach the heavy metal style without committing too much time. The last step for the Space Marine itself was to highlight the gold by mixing it with a bit of silver from the same range. And I am keeping it very simple because it is nearly time to wrap up. The Space Marine is done, but as you can see, I left a few unpainted elements on the right side. This is because I actually finished painting this diorama on Christmas Eve and had to cool it down so we could shoot and share a few photos on Christmas Day. I'll paint those eventually, but after working on it sick like hell for days, we need to cool it down and move on to something else. Alright, now that the ultramarine is done, let's have fun with the rest of the diorama. Starting with the Necron's body, with deep red highlights, same as for the head. And as body and lips will be stuffed in a box, I am of course focusing on the parts that will actually be visible. I am painting the symbol on the chest with hull red, as this will be painted in gold. Cables are base coated in black. and recesses are shaded with a black wash. And now, just as we did with the Necron's parts on the Space Marine, I am going to highlight the body by progressively increasing the ratio of ivory for deep red. Looks like someone actually left a note, but you can't even read this without a macro lens. Using Canoptek alloy, I am painting the metallic parts on the body and a few cables. A black wash here and there for extra depth, and the only thing left to paint on the body is the gold symbol and a few power cables. Onto the base, starting with the cardboard Christmas tree. As for all the gold elements, I am base coating the Canoptek scarabs with hot red. Same for the tree trunk. I am then painting edge highlights with a mix of frog and deep green, finishing with pure frog green for the brighter highlights. For the base itself, I am dry brushing Valero gunmetal to build a heavy texture. All the Canoptek scarabs are then painted in gold. Again, this paint is super shiny, particularly when exposed to direct light. The scarab garland is painted the same way. The carapace is then painted in Valero black, tinned on as a wash, and applied in all the recesses. The carapace is then highlighted with a mix of ivory and black, and nearly pure ivory over a few brighter edges. This is the same process as for the one connected to the Space Marine, but you have here a much better view. The orb thingy is then painted in ivory as a base for the fluorescent paint. Same for the eye slash lens globe. The gold is then highlighted with a mix of gold and silver. The scarab's orbs are then painted using AK fluorescent paints. Yellow, blue, pink, and orange. Fluorescent paints are very delicate and need 2 or 3 layers. I actually added a bit of deep red to the fluorescent orange for more contrast. Same for the pink to make it more intense. An OSA glow is then painted for each color over the carapace. Last, all the presents that will stand at the bottom of the Christmas tree. Painting the ribbons, highlighting the boxes, and adding some effects to the Necron's box. The smaller present boxes will be in the background, and we don't need them to be super clean or detailed. They are here to complement and add a bit of fun to the background. You might have noticed that we are recycling the colors that we use for the Space Marine and the Necron, again with the intention of limiting the color palette as much as possible. A bit of praise for the one who nicely wrapped this bottle rifle. Look at how convincing the ribbon is. I am sure you can come up with a few creative ideas using this technique. A last bit of freehand and all the presents are done. Time to assemble all those parts together. Alright, everything's in place. And with that done, time to enjoy the final reveal. There you go. We hope that you enjoyed this diorama and video, and with the holidays behind us, we can now focus on bringing you more content. Take care, and we'll see you in the next video. See ya! Starting with the Necron's body with deep red highlights, same as for the head.